Good morning, students. Today we'll be studying the lungs, the pleura, and the bronchopulmonary segments. This is Dr. Yusuf here. These are some of the objectives which are related to our university, that is to the College of Medicine, Al-Jouf University. So the first objective is name and identify the lobes, fissures, hilla, surfaces and borders of the lungs. Mention the clinical importance of the fissures of the lungs. List the difference between the right and left lungs. Describe the pulmonary nerve plexuses as regards formation, location and distribution. List and identify the impression of the structures in relation to mediastinal surfaces of both the lungs. Outline the blood supply and lymphatic drainage of the lungs. Define, name the bronchopulmonary segments of the lungs and mention their clinical importance. Describe the surface anatomy of the pleura and lungs. Describe the pleura and differentiate its parietal and visceral layers. Follow the reflections of the pleura. Name and locate the recesses of pleura and mention their clinical importance. Mention the relations of the cervical pleura. Outline the blood supply and lymphatic drainage of the pleura. Describe the nerve supply of pleura and explain referred pain associated with it. Define the suprapleural membrane and mention its characters. So these are some of the objectives which are for you. And we'll try to cover as much as possible, because these objectives are not only related just to your lecture, but some of the objectives will be used or to be covered in the PBL sessions, some in the TBL, some in seminars, some in the STLs, and so forth. So we'll try to cover as much as possible. The remaining objectives will be covered somewhere else. First of all, the lungs. As you know, the lungs are a pair of essential organs of respiration. Without this, there is no respiration. So these are the most essential organs for respiration. If you see the character of these lungs, they are porous, highly porous. Porous means with lot of spaces in between. It has lot of holes or spaces within which the respiration will be taking place. So there is lots of cavities within the lungs. It is highly elastic because it has to expand as well as relax during respiration. So it is highly elastic in nature, as well as because of its elasticity, it is spongy in texture. So if you see the lungs of a newborn, these will be rosy pink in color. But as the child keeps on growing, at the same time he'll be respiring the atmospheric air with the lot of pollutants, especially the carbon particles which are there in the atmosphere. It becomes much darker. It becomes almost dark gray in adults due to deposition of the carbon particles. If you touch these lungs, because of the presence of air within the lungs, it makes some sounds. This is called as crepitation. Crepitates. When you touch it, it crepitates on touch. Okay, it makes some sounds. Cruck cruck sounds. These are called as crepitations. So it crepitates on touch. In case of medical legal point, to find out whether the newborn was died before it took a birth, or it was it died after the birth because of the doctor's negligence or some other reasons. So this can be confirmed by just removing, in case of autopsy, you remove the lungs and put it in a bucket of water, and if the lungs floats on water, then it means that the child has taken respiration. So it means there was a life bulb. After that, there was some cause of death. And if it doesn't float, it sinks to the bottom of the bucket, then it means the newborn was stillbirth. So this is one of the legal, medical legal point which is essential in case of the forensic medicine. This lung, if you see the lung, the root of the lung, it will have the trachea and the primary bronchial, secondary and tertiary bronchial. All these looks like the tree and the branches of a tree or the roots of a tree. So it is called as bronchopulmonary tree. We will discuss about this in detail later. This lung is invaginated by a pleural sac. Actually, the lung invaginates into the pleural sac, and it will, the pleural sac with its coverings will differentiate itself into a parietal pleura and visceral pleura. Again, we'll discuss in detail about all these things later. Coming to the lung, the presenting parts of a lung, if you see the lung, it looks like a pyramid. So it has an apex at the top, then it has a base at the bottom, which is in contact with the dome of the diaphragm. This is the diaphragm, which separates the thoracic contents from the abdominal cavity. So this is the dome of the diaphragm. So this above that will be the base of the diaphragm, and this is the apex of the lung. This is the base of the lung. It will have two surfaces, the costal surface, which is in relation to the costa. Costa means ribs. So it is in contact with the chest wall. That part of the lung will be called as the costal surface. The other surface, which is on the medial side towards the heart, this surface will be called as the medial surface. Coming to the borders, it will have three borders. This picture is not very clear for the borders. We will discuss about these borders again in detail. Just now, just remember that there are three borders. One is the anterior border, posterior border, and the inferior border. So I will show you the other pictures where it is much more clear to see these borders. So the lung has an apex. So this is the apex. This is the base. It has two surfaces, costal surface and the medial surface, and three borders, anterior, posterior, as well as inferior border. Now coming to the apex, if you see the apex, it is at the root of the neck. So it is rounded in nature. It is not sharp as such, as a pyramid with its apex should be. It is rounded at the upper end, at the root of the neck. And it is almost 3 to 4 centimeters above the first costal cartilage. This is the first rib, and this is the first costal cartilage. From here, if you measure, it is almost 3 to 4 centimeters above the costal cartilage. Then we have it is almost 2.5 centimeters above the medial end of the clavicle. If you see the medial end of the clavicle, almost it is 2.5 centimeters from the medial end of the clavicle. Then it is covered. It is not as such open in nature, but it is covered by a part of the pleura which will be called as the cervical pleura. So cervical pleura will be covering this apex, and again this is covered by a membrane called as the suprapleural membrane. Above this pleura there will be a membrane which is called as the suprapleural membrane. Coming to the base, if you can see here, this is the dome of the diaphragm, and here is the base of the lung. This is the lung here, this is the base of the lung. If you see here, the shape is almost semilunar because of the presence of the liver here, and it gives the dome of the diaphragm itself will give this shape. So it is almost semilunar, half moon shape, and it is concave downwards. If you can see here, it is concave and it is downwards, facing downwards. Relations are important for the base, especially in clinical settings like during pleural effusion and other things. When you do these procedures, you are supposed to know where exactly you are supposed to put the needle and what are the structures which are there which can be damaged. So if you see the relations, so on the right side, so here below this dome of the diaphragm is present, and below that there is the right lobe of the liver. So the right lobe of the liver will be present here, and on the left side, if you see, here also is the base of the left lung. So on the left side we can trace the fundus of the stomach, as well as there is also an important structure here, that is the spleen, which is in direct contact with the chest wall. So these structures are in relation in the base. Coming to the coastal surface is that surface which is in contact with the costa, that is the ribs here. Okay, so this is the coastal surface, which is convex in nature as well as it is smooth and related with the lateral thoracic wall. So this is the lateral thoracic wall. These are the ribs and the intercostal spaces filled with intercostal structures. So all this will form the lateral thoracic wall. So this coastal surface is in contact with the lateral thoracic wall, and it is separated, the lung, it is separated from the thoracic wall by a covering of the pleura, that will be called as the coastal pleura. And because during respiration the person will be respiring and the lungs will expand and relax, this will lead to impressions on the lungs itself. If you see, if you remove the actual lung and see, it will have the impressions of the ribs as well as the coastal cartilages. Okay, if you see on the surface of the coastal surface of the lung, there will be depressions, which are the depressions because of the presence of the ribs. The medial surface is the, this is the medial surface, which is facing towards the heart, and the structures on the medial surface or the mediastinal surface. So the medial surface consists of two parts. It is divided into two parts. One is the posterior part, or it is also called as the vertebral part, because the part of this medial surface which is in contact with the vertebra, that will be called as the vertebral part, and the part which is in contact with the mediastinal structures and the heart, that will be called as the mediastinal part. So there are two parts: vertebral part, which is in relation to the bodies of the vertebra as well as the intervertebral disc, and the mediastinal part is that part which is in contact with the heart and other mediastinal structures. Here you can see, here this is the mediastinal surface, here this is the mediastinal surface which has been cut and removed, that part of the lung has been removed, so that you can see the mediastinal surface structures as well as the heart itself. So this is the mediastinal surface, and the part which is posterior, that will be called as the vertebral part. Coming to the borders, so here is the picture which shows the borders very clearly. The anterior border, how do you identify the anterior border? Anterior border is thin and sharp. We can see here, this is thin and sharp compared with the posterior border, which is rounded and thick. Okay, so this is how we can differentiate. The anterior border will be sharp and thin, and it is continuous from above downwards, from the apex till the base in the right lung. But in case of the left lung, because of the heart is towards the left side, so because of the presence of the heart, the anterior border is incomplete and it gives a notch here. This notch will be called as the cardiac notch. Because of the presence of the heart on the left side, this anterior border is incomplete and this gives a notch on the anterior border. This is called as the cardiac notch. And below this cardiac notch, there is an elongation of the anterior border. This will be called as the, it is something like a tongue. So it is called as the lingula. So this cardiac notch and lingula are present on the anterior border of the left lung. It is not present on the right lung, but in the right lung, it will be just like a simple projection of the anterior border completely, and it is complete. But on the left side, it gives a notch called as the cardiac notch because the presence of the heart, and below this cardiac notch there is a tongue like elongation. This will be called as the lingula. Coming to the posterior border, as I said, it is thick and rounded, and it is in relation to the bodies of the vertebrae as well as the 10 upper ribs. So this posterior border will be rounded, thick, as well as in relation to the vertebrae as well as the heads of the ribs. Okay, so this is the posterior border. So, and this is the anterior border. If the specimen is given of the lung, this is the first thing you are supposed to identify, the apex and the base. See the apex, this is sharp, almost sharp, and the base, which is broad and below, and then trace the anterior border, which will be thin and sharp, and the posterior border, which will be rounded and thick. And now try to identify the side depending on the with the hilum. This is the hilum, or the root of the lung, or hilum is any part of this organ where the structures either will be entering or they will be coming out. Like the arteries will be entering here and the veins will be draining from here. So this is not only for this organ, but for any other organ. If there is the root, that is the area where the structures will be either entering or they will be coming out. The arteries will be supplying, the veins will be draining, the lymphatic drainage will be there, which will be coming out. The nerve supply will be passing through this. All this will be in the root, the hilum of the structure. Here, for this is for the root of the lung, or the hilum of the lung. Okay. So the structures will not enter the organs in any other part. Okay, all other surfaces will be almost smooth. So all the structures should enter or come out through this root of the lung, and this is also called as the hilum of the lung. Okay. The inferior border is also sharp and rounded, and it is towards the base. So this is the base of the lung. So around the base of the lung, this is a sharp border, which is thin and sharp, and toward the base of the lung. So this is how you can identify the three borders: anterior border, posterior border, as well as the inferior border. Coming to the fissures, both the lungs will have a prominent fissure, which will be not horizontal or vertical. It will be almost oblique like. Okay, so here you can see the oblique fissure. So this is the oblique fissure, which is present both on the right side as well as the left lung. Along with this oblique fissure, the right lung will have an additional fissure. This is called as the horizontal fissure. This is the horizontal fissure, which is an additional fissure only on the right side. So this is an additional fissure, which is not present on the left side, only on the right side. So the right lung will have two fissures. One is the horizontal fissure, which is present here, and the other one is the oblique fissure. But on the left side, there is only one fissure, which is called as the oblique fissure. So on the left side, the part of the lung which is above the oblique fissure, that will be called as the superior lobe. The part of the lung which is below the oblique fissure, this will be called as the inferior lobe. But in case of right lung, there is an additional fissure, horizontal fissure, which the area between the horizontal fissure and the oblique fissure, this fissure will be the middle lobe. So on the right side, the area of the lung which is above the horizontal fissure, that will be called as the superior lobe. The part of the lung which is between the horizontal and the oblique fissure, this will be called as the middle lobe. And the part of the lung below the oblique fissure will be called as the inferior lobe. So on the right side we have two fissures, and on the left side there is only one fissure. So on the right side there are three lobes: superior, middle, as well as the inferior. And on the left side there are only two lobes: superior and the inferior lobe. Now we have to know we have to differentiate. One is we have differentiated the right lung and left lung with the number of fissures. As I said, on the left side there is only one fissure and on the right side there are two fissures. Then there are two lobes on the left side and there are three lobes on the right side. Along with that, the impressions on the mediastinal surface of the lung also can be differentiated depending on the side of the lung. So the impressions of the right side of the lung will be different from that of the left side. So there can be a question in the examination to differentiate between the mediastinal surface of the right lung and the left lung. So you should be able to differentiate the structures which gives the impression on the mediastinal surface of the right lung and the left lung. Here the structures have been shown. Actually the structures will not be present, just you have to identify the area which will be giving impression on that particular site. But here the structures have been shown so that you can imagine how exactly these structures will give the impression. Okay, so here if the first structure which you are supposed to identify will be the azygous vein. If you see here, this is the root of the lung or the hilum of the lung. Just above and behind the root of the lung, this is the arch of azygous vein. This is the arch of azygous vein. This is the mediastinal surface and this is the posterior or vertebral surface. Okay, of the medial surface. This is the whole thing is the medial surface. This is the posterior or vertebral surface and this is the mediastinal surface where the mediastinal structures will be there. So what we are discussing are the structures which gives the impression on the mediastinal surface of the lung. So the first structure which you are supposed to identify is the arch of azygous vein. So here is the arch which is making an arch on the hilum as well as behind the hilum or the root of the lung. So this should be differentiated on the right side. If you see the right side, there is also an arch, but it is not because of the azygous vein, but the arch of aorta will be there. So this is on the left side, where you can see the arch of aorta. So this should be differentiated from the arch of azygous vein. On the right side will be the arch of azygous vein. On the left side it will be the arch of aorta. So this is one differentiating point. The second important impression on the right side of the mediastinal surface of the lung is the superior vena cava. If you see here, this arch of azygous vein will drain into the superior vena cava. This is the superior vena cava, which will in turn drains into the heart. So here will be the heart. So the third structure which will be present here, which will give the impression, is the heart itself. Heart has not been shown here, so that you can see here will be the heart, and this heart will give the impression, not the whole heart but the right side of the heart, especially the right atrium as well as the right ventricle will have its impression, and this superior vena cava will be opening into the right atrium. Then we have the inferior vena cava, which is also opening into the right atrium. So here you can see the inferior vena cava that will give the impression again on the mediastinal surface. Then we have the right brachiocephalic vein, that is the vein which is draining into the superior vena cava, which form the right and the left brachiocephalic vein. From the right and left side will join together. This is the left brachiocephalic vein, this is the right brachiocephalic vein, which together will join together to form the superior vena cava. So you can see the right brachiocephalic vein. Even if you continue behind this, the right subclavian vein is draining into the brachiocephalic vein, right brachiocephalic vein. So even the right subclavian vein also gives the impression here, as well as the right subclavian artery. So that is the artery, main artery which supply the upper limb. The right subclavian vein is the main vein which drains the upper limb. So these two structures will be supplying as well as draining the upper limb. So this is a very important artery and the vein which will be supplying and draining respectively the upper limb. So these structures also give the impression. So you can see the subclavian artery, subclavian vein, which drains into the right brachiocephalic vein, and the right and left brachiocephalic vein will join together to form the superior vena cava, which is also drained by the azygous vein. And superior vena cava and the inferior vena cava will drain into right atrium. So all these structures can be seen. Along with that, even here there will be the trachea. which is again not shown here, so it will give an impression. So above the hilum of the lung. So below the hilum or on the hilum, it is not present because it divides already to primary bronchus, and here you can see the bronchus, the primary bronchus has already divided, and it is going to the it has already divided even into the secondary bronchi. It had started dividing into the secondary bronchi here. So here you can see the hepatia bronchus, two secondary bronchus are already there. The third will be developed when it enters the lung. Next, we have behind the hilum, there is also impression of the esophagus here. So this is a structure which is behind the hilum. So these are some of the important structures which gives the impression on the mediastinal surface of the lung. Coming to the left side is also is very important, because you should be able to differentiate between the right and the left. One I said is the arch of aorta on the left side, around the above the hilum as well as behind the hilum, there is the impression of the arch of aorta as well as the descending thoracic aorta. Along with that, there will be also the thoracic duct, which has not been shown here, which will be also present. Then we have the impression of the esophagus. Esophagus was present on the right side also. Here also it gives the impressions. Then we have the cardiac impressions, which are in front of the hilum of the lung. So this is the impression of the heart, but it is of the left side of the left atrium, as well as the ventricle will give the impression. And above, if you see here, we can see the left subclavian artery, which is a branch from the arch of aorta, which is also giving impression, as well as the left subclavian vein, as well as the brachiocephalic vein. Okay, so these are the structures. The left subclavian artery will be supplying the main artery, which supply the upper limb, and the left subclavian vein, which will be present here, and which drains into the left brachiocephalic vein, will be the main vein which drains the upper limb. So all these impressions will be there. So here you should observe that it is the left subclavian artery and the left brachiocephalic vein. There it was on the right brachiocephalic artery and the vein. So you should be able to differentiate all these structures. Okay. Now, after the impressions of the structures around the hilum, now you should be able also to differentiate between the differences between the hilum of the right side and the left side. There are some differences even in the hilum. So what are those differences? Now, first difference is the two bronchi. So on the right side, there will be two bronchi I showed you in the picture. So when the trachea comes down, it divides into two primary bronchi. So here will be the trachea, and it divides into two primary bronchi. So these are the two bronchi. So this primary bronchi divides into lobar bronchi or the secondary bronchi. So on the right side, there are three lobes, so it will divide into three, and on the left side it will be dividing into two, because there are only two lobes. But as I had told you before, that the right bronchus is shorter as well as wider, and it divides already extra pulmonary outside the lung itself into the secondary bronchi. It starts dividing, but it gets completed only once it enters the lung itself. So initially it divides into two. Okay, even though there are three lobes, it initially divides into two, then enters the lung, and the third secondary bronchi will be formed within the lung. So the part which is outside the lung, that will be called as the extrapulmonary. The part which is inside, that will be called as the intrapulmonary parts of this bronchi. So the right bronchus is shorter. So right primary bronchus is shorter, wider, and it divides into initially into two, and it enters the lung. If you see here, so these are the two impressions of the secondary bronchi. Then it goes, enters the lung, then it gives the third division, which will be supplying actually the three lobes of the lung. Okay, so in case of the right lung, there will be one above, one below. The above one will be called as the hip arterial bronchus. The lower one will be called as the hip arterial bronchus. So the above one will be the hip arterial bronchus. This is the hip arterial bronchus. Here in this picture, you can see the primary bronchus dividing into two. Then once it enters, then it will divide into the third one. But on the left side, I had told you that the left primary bronchus is longer, narrower, and it is more oblique. So it doesn't divide outside, but once it enters, only then it divides into two bronchus. So when you see at the root of the lung, you can see only one. Okay, even though here you can see it is almost started dividing, but it is not complete. Okay, so they are not complete. So here you can see they are completely separated too, but here they are not completely separated. So it is only one. So the single bronchus, it is going and it is started dividing, but it is not complete. So it is going inside and then it divides into two. So on the left side, it will be only one bronchus. On the right side, it will be two bronchus. And if you see the blood supply, the right lung is supplied by only one bronchial artery, but the left side is supplied by the left lung is supplied by the two bronchial arteries. So that is the second difference. Then the other features are similar. So this is also supplied by one, the right and the left both are supplied by one pulmonary artery and the two pulmonary veins, and both drain into bronchopulmonary lymph nodes. So these are some of the upper one and two are the main differences. The right side will have two bronchus, the left one will have one bronchus. The second feature is the right lung is supplied by one bronchial artery, the left lung is supplied by the two bronchial arteries. Now coming to the bronchopulmonary segments. These bronchopulmonary segments are pyramidal shaped, wedge shaped independent segments of the lungs, aerated by segmental or tertiary bronchus. So if you see, this is the trachea. It divides into right and left primary bronchus. Primary bronchus will divide into secondary bronchus, also called as the lobar bronchus, depending on the number of lobes. And these lobar bronchus will in turn divide into tertiary bronchus, which are also called as the segmental bronchus. So these segmental bronchus aerate a small area of the lung, which is almost pyramid-like shape, and they are all directed towards the root of the lung. So this area aerated by a single segment of the tertiary bronchus will be called as the bronchopulmonary segment. So bronchopulmonary segment is that segment which is aerated by a small area, aerated by a single tertiary bronchus or the segmental bronchus. So that area of the lung which is aerated by the segmental bronchus or tertiary bronchus is called as the bronchopulmonary segments. So as I said, it is wedge shape or pyramidal shape with the apex directed toward the root. So all this lung is divided into small areas of pyramid shape, all their apexes are directed toward the root of the lung. So each lung has 10 bronchopulmonary segments. Initially, previously they used to think that because the right lung is slightly bigger as well as it has 3 lobes, so it has 10 segments. Because the left lobe has only 2 lobes, so it has 8 segments. But later, the recent thing is that both the lungs have 10 bronchopulmonary segments. So now how they are actually divided into 10 bronchopulmonary segments. Now we can see, and we can also differentiate between the right and the left lung. If you see the upper lobe is divided into 3 segments. The part above at the apex, that will be called as the apical segment. Then we have an anterior segment as well as the posterior bronchopulmonary segment. Similarly, on the left side also same. One part is at the top part will be called as the apical. Then we have the anterior segment and the posterior segment. The middle lobe of the right lung will be divided into a part which is medial, that is called as the medial segment, and a part which is called as the lateral segment. So these are the bronchopulmonary segments of the middle lobe. But the left lung doesn't have middle lobe. So how the segments are equal on both the sides. So the middle lobe, instead of middle lobe, the lingula acts as the middle lobe here, and it is divided into an upper part, which is called as the superior lingular, and the part below that will be called as the inferior lingular part. So these are the two segments of the left lung which are present in the lingula, which are very similar to the middle, which acts as the middle lobe of the right lung. Now the lower part, again both the lungs will have the similar names, that is called as the apical basal, then medial basal, lateral basal, anterior basal and posterior basal. These are the very similar on both the right side and the left side. So here we can see these are the three in upper lobe, middle lobe has 2, 5 and these 5 in the lower lobe. Similarly here for the left lung, 3 in the upper lobe, 2 in the lingula and 5 in the lower lobe. So 10 in each segment. So these segments will be called as the bronchopulmonary segment. Now if you see the picture, this is how they look like. So here you can see in the upper lobe, this is the apical segment. So then we have the anterior segment, then this is the posterior segment. So in the similar case, in case of middle lobe, we have the medial segment as well as the lateral segment. And inferiorly, if you see here, this is the inferior lobe, we have the superior segment, that is the apical basal, then we have the anterior basal, lateral basal, posterior basal, and on the other side will be the medial basal. So this is for the right lung. Similarly for the left lung also it will be present. So here you can see the apical, anterior as well as posterior. So here it has been clubbed together to form the apico-posterior. Then we have the for the lingula, superior lingular as well as the inferior lingular, and in the basal, in the base of the lung or the lower lobe of the lung, we can see the this is the apical segment, we have the anterior basal, posterior basal, lateral basal and medial basal. So this is how the lung is divided into segments. So this each segment supplied by or aerated by a single tertiary bronchus or the segmental bronchus is called as the bronchopulmonary segment. This is each bronchopulmonary segment. So there are 10 on the right side, 10 on the left side. Now what is the clinical importance of having these segments? Why should we study these segments? So there are some very important basic features which are very much helpful and which are necessary to be known, which are clinically very important for the treatment. So the first one is, whenever there are infections, they are usually restricted to a particular segment. So that is very important. So whenever we see the infection, they are related or they are confined to a particular segment, one or two segments, and this is very important in case of treating the patient. One is whenever there is infection and if it cannot be treated, then with the antibiotics and other things, then this first of all, we should study when there is infection and if it cannot be treated by antibiotics, then we can have something called as the postural drainage. Depending on the position, the pus or collection of pus or lung abscess can be drained from these parts. If it is in apical or in the basal, depending on the position, we have to change the position of the person itself and try to drain it through the gravity. So if the infected segment is in the right lung, then ask the patient to lie on the left side so that it can be easily drained toward the left side. Similarly, if it is on the left side, you can ask the person to lie on the right side. Similarly, if it is in the apex, ask the person to be more in the vertical position. And if it is basal, you should lift the lower limbs and the lower part of the body so that it can be easily drained through the gravity. So this is called as the postural drainage. So the knowledge of the segments and the which segment is infected is very important so that it can help in the drainage of the lung abscesses as well as the pus in case of the bronchiectasis. And if it cannot be drained, if it cannot be treated by antibiotics, it cannot be drained, then if you want to remove that particular segment, if it is untreatable, then you can remove that particular segment and get rid of this infection. Previously, when they did not have the knowledge of this segment, they used to remove the whole lobe, and this used to really affect the person's breathing capacity, the volume itself. So it used to affect a lot. Nowadays, because of the knowledge of this segment, that particular segment can be removed, and that will be really helpful for the patient to get rid of that infection. So segmental resection can be done instead of lobectomy. Lobectomy is the whole removing of the whole lobe. So whole lobe removing is really dangerous for the person because it's really affect the volume of the exchange. Okay, so this knowledge of this bronchopulmonary segment is really helpful in case of the postural drainage as well as the segmental resections. But in case of tuberculosis, as I had mentioned before here, in case of tuberculosis as well as the bronchogenic carcinoma, these two diseases are such that they don't follow the rule of segmentation. So they are they actually spread throughout the lung, most of the part of the lung, and they don't follow this rule of the segmentation. So they are not very much helpful in case of the tuberculosis as well as in case of the bronchogenic carcinoma. Okay, now coming to the blood supply. The blood supply of the lung, this is supplied by the bronchial arteries. There is difference, as I had told. The right lung is supplied by one bronchial artery, and the left side is supplied, left lung is supplied by the two bronchial arteries. If you see here in this picture, so this picture you can see here, there is, this is the posterior intercostal artery. This is the first intercostal, second intercostal, this is the third posterior intercostal artery. This gives a branch, this is called as the right bronchial artery, and it will be supplying not only bronchus as well as the lung also. But on the left side, the origin of this bronchial artery is not from the intercostal artery but from the descending thoracic aorta itself. If you can see here, just behind the this left bronchus, you can see the origin of this artery from the descending thoracic aorta. This is called as the left bronchial artery. There are two left bronchial arteries which supply the bronchus as well as the lung itself. So one difference is the right lung is supplied by one bronchial artery, left side is supplied by the left two bronchial arteries. The second is the origin itself has a difference. On the right side is taking origin from the bronchial artery is taking origin from the third posterior intercostal artery. On the left side, it is taking origin from the descending thoracic aorta. Okay, so this is the difference in the origin of the two arteries on the two sides. Coming to the venous drainage, this venous drainage is mainly into the pulmonary veins and into the bronchial veins. Coming to the nerve supply to these lungs is by the autonomic nervous system. The parasympathetic is from the vagus, which are motor to the bronchial muscles, that is they help in the constriction of the bronchus and bronchioles. So they are bronchospasmic, as well as secretomotor to mucous glands, as well as sensory for stretch reflexes. If there is any stretch, extra additional stretch, then you feel the pain or the pressure because of this vagus nerve. So they are sensory for stretch reflexes. Coming to the sympathetic part of this, it is by from the thoracic second to fifth, second thoracic spinal nerve, third, fourth and fifth spinal nerves. They all will be second to fifth will be thoracic, will be acting as the sympathetic, and they are mainly inhibitory to smooth muscles as well as the gland. So whenever they are stimulated, then there will be less mucus secretion as well as the activity of the gland. Coming to the lymphatic drainage, it is for both the sides, it is the bronchopulmonary lymph nodes. Bronchopulmonary lymph nodes are those lymph nodes which are around the trachea as well as the bronchi. So here will be these bronchopulmonary lymph nodes, and both the lungs will be draining into the bronchopulmonary lymph nodes. Now coming to the differences between the right and the left lung. Again, this can be an important short notes, so you should know the differences between the right lung, not only on the mediastinal surface, not only on the hilum, in general both the right and the left lung also. So if you see the right lung is much shorter, wider, and has more capacity for the air. But the left lung is, because of the presence of heart on the left side, it has narrowed on, it has become much more narrower, as well as longer, as well as it has less capacity or the less volume. Coming to the weight, weight is almost slightly more of the right side, right lung compared to the left side, because of the larger, wider lung. So it is almost 625 grams to 650 grams, but on the left side it is almost 50 grams lesser, almost 550 to 575 grams. Coming to the number of lobes and fissures, as you know already, there are three lobes on the right side and two fissures. For the left lung, it will be two lobes and one fissure. If you see the base, it is more concave on the right side compared to the left side, because I said on the right side there is the lung itself, which will make it much more concave compared to the left side, which is much shallower compared to the concave right side. If you see the anterior border, I had shown you that there is a cardiac notch because of the presence of the heart on the left side. So the anterior border is not complete, but there is a cardiac notch which is absent on the right side. And if you see the arrangement of structures at the hilum from above downwards, you can see there are two bronchus on the right side, hip arteria as well as hip arteria. So the arrangement is different of the right side and the left side. On the right side, the first structure will be the bronchus, hip arterial bronchus. Then we have the artery, then we have the hip arterial bronchus, then the vein. But on the left side, we have only one bronchus. So the first will be the artery, then the bronchus, as well as the vein. So these will be the arrangement above downwards. Coming to the cardiac impression, because the heart is more on the left side, so it is the impression of the heart on the left side is much more deeper compared to the right side. And if you see, as we had seen the cardiac node, just below the cardiac node there is an elongation of the lung that is called the lingula, which is prominent on the left side, but there is no lingula on the right side because there is no cardiac notch, so there is no lingula. So the anterior border of the right lung is much more straighter. And the blood, coming to the blood supply, the right lung is supplied by only one bronchial artery, but the left lung is supplied by two bronchial arteries. So these are some of the differences which you are supposed to know, and it can be important for the examination point of view. Coming to the applied aspects, as I had told you that the right principal bronchus is much more wider and more in line with the trachea, because the trachea is slightly deviated toward the right side. It is not exactly in the midline, but slightly deviated toward the right side, and the right bronchus is also almost vertical and much more wider and in line with that of the trachea. Hence the chances of falling border entering the right bronchus is much more compared to the left side. Hence, a falling body is likely to be aspirated into the right lung more commonly than into the left lung. This is one of the important clinical aspects. Okay, we were discussing about the segments, and it has been observed by many studies that if you see the tuberculosis, is mainly usually it infects the posterior segment of the upper lobe. This is has been observed by many cases. Even though tuberculosis doesn't follow the rule or the barriers of the segment, well, it spreads widely, but initially it starts from the, it has been observed that it starts from the posterior segment of the upper lobe. That is, this is quite different for the carcinomas. If you see the bronchogenic carcinomas, it will be more initially it will start from the anterior segments of the upper lobe, and then it spreads to other parts. So this is the difference. If you see the tuberculosis, it will start from the posterior segment, and in case of carcinomas, it starts from the anterior segment of the upper lobe. And the apical segment of the lower lobe is the common site for the aspiration of the lung abscesses. If you see, usually the aspirations of the lung abscess, you will be usually, it is observed that it will be the apical segment of the lower lobe. One more important feature you are supposed to know in case of lung is there are two things. One is called as the azygous lobe and the second one is called as the lobe of azygous vein. Azygous lobe is nothing but the additional lobe. Sometimes due to developmental anomaly, there can be an accessory as well as supernumerary lobe, which can be either on the right side or on the left side, which is nothing but an additional lobe. Small lobe may be functional or non-functional, might be a small lobe on the right or left side. So this is called as the azygous lobe. The second feature is the lobe of azygous vein. We had seen in the previous slide the position of the azygous veins. If you remember this picture where we had discussed that there is the arching of the azygous vein, so it is above and behind the hilum. So this is the azygous vein. Sometimes arching, instead of arching on the hilum, it will arch on the upper lobe, superior lobe. So it will arch on the superior lobe itself and it invaginates into the superior lobe and it divides partially the lobe into two lobes. So this is additional lobe here because of the arching of the azygous vein on the upper lobe will be called as the lobe of azygous vein. So this will be called as the lobe of azygous vein. So this is the azygous lobe, which is an additional lobe, and the lobe of azygous vein, which is an abnormality in arching of the azygous vein, which will, instead of arching above and behind the hilum of the lung, the right lung, it will arch over the upper lobe of the right lung, and it will give an additional maybe incomplete lobe. This is called as the lobe of azygous vein. This is seen in 1% of the upper lobe of the right lung, where apex of the lung splits into median lateral parts by a fissure containing the azygous vein. Because of the arching, there will be a fissure which will contain the azygous vein, and it is when it suspend, it not only it suspend, it will take along with that by a pleural septum. It also, because the upper lobe is covered by the pleura, it takes a part of the pleura, and this will be called as the mesoazygous. So this form the mesoazygous. So when arching above the upper lobe of the right lung, it not only arch over the lung, but along with that it also take a part of the pleura because the lobe is covered by the pleura, and this suspended pleura will be called as the mesoazygous. So this is about the lung, and if you have any doubt regarding this, you can definitely ask me. Okay, thank you very much.